Amen.
So at LifeSpring, we would call ourselves a spirit and truth church, word and spirit. What does that mean? Well, to put simply, we believe that the Bible is the word of God. We've got high value for the Bible. Believe it's a manual for our life. It's something that we can look to, the truth by which we live. It's a pillar to base our life upon. And combined with that pillar, we believe that we can experience and know God's Holy Spirit at work in our lives, don't we? That the Holy Spirit's living, active, that the Holy Spirit's been deposited in us, and we can know his power, his life in us. And these two pillars, word and spirit, or spirit and truth, are foundational to every aspect of our life together as a church. And they should shape everything that we do, and that includes when we worship together. Jesus said in John 4, said this, "Yet a time is coming and has now come when true worshippers will worship the Father in the spirit and the truth, and in truth. For they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the spirit and in truth." So there's a clear command. Jesus tells us to worship in spirit and in truth. So how does that practically affect our worship? John Piper says that worship must be vital and real in the heart, and worship must rest on a true perception of God. There must be spirit and there must be truth. Truth without emotion produces dead orthodoxy and a church full or half full of artificial admirers. On the other hand, emotion without truth produces empty frenzy and cultivates shallow people who refuse the discipline of rigorous thought. But true worship comes from people who are deeply emotional, who love deep and sound doctrine. Strong affections for God, rooted in truth, are the bone and marrow of biblical worship. We want to be a people of both, don't we? Of both the truth of who God is and encountering his Holy Spirit. So my kids have a trampoline in our garden. It's one of their most favourite toys. You can find them out there, come rain or shine, bouncing away. And they've got this game where it's called Crack the Egg. Has anyone heard of it? So one of them sits in the middle, kind of all crunched up, and the rest of them kind of go round. And the whole idea is to bounce them as high as they can so the egg gets broken. That's the idea. It's incredibly dangerous, and we've got a long list of injuries, but they love it. But the whole point is they have to jump deep into the trampoline in order to get higher. And that's what I want to do today. That's what I want to help us do. I want to jump deep into the practicals, actually, of how we worship and why we worship, in order that we can then go higher in our worship times together, that we can encounter the heights and the breadth of who God is. Because we need both. We need that understanding, the deep thought, and then our experience to match that as well. That's what we want to do today. So it's going to be a slightly different morning, actually. It's going to be more of the practicals of how we put things together, rather than necessarily the theological reasons why we do certain things. I'll touch on those, but I just want to give you a heads up where we're going. So as I said, it's vital to dig down in order to go higher. And simply put, the why, the who and the how feed the wonder and the wow in worship. Yeah, it's good that, isn't it? The why, the who and the how feed the wonder and the wow in worship. So we've established why we worship in spirit and truth. Jesus told us. Yeah, John 4, very simple. And we're a church who want to be authentic followers of Jesus. That means following his lead, his guidance, his words for us. And we know who we are to worship. It's the God of the Bible, Father, Son, Spirit. Bible makes that abundantly clear. So my question for us this morning is, how then do we worship in spirit and truth? How do we go about doing it? Have you ever wondered about the practicalities of our corporate worship time? The way in which we worship to God? How should we structure singing songs of worship during the meeting? Why do we have fast songs at the start? Mid-tempo ones in the middle, slow ones at the end. Why does the worship leader keep telling me that I should keep singing? Is he not happy with his own voice? It depends on the morning, but yeah. Why does that one person insist on grabbing the mic down the front and speaking in that weird language every week? If you've not had those questions in your mind before, you probably do now, and I probably just set myself up for difficulty. But we're going to go on a whistle-stop tour of how we build our worship times with that backdrop of spirit and truth. From putting song lists together to how we should expect to use spiritual gifts during our worship times together. Okay, here we go. You ready? You with me? Great. Preparation. Just like it's taken me time to prepare this message, those that lead worship actually do spend time before God praying and planning to lead you on a Sunday morning. So picture this. Let me take you to a small room in the bottom of my garden on a Thursday morning. I've just spent time worshiping God, praying, getting before him as I begin to think about us meeting together on a Sunday. God, what do you want to say? What do you want to do? Where do you want to lead us? Have you ever thought about how we actually put the song list together? Let's do a quick poll, okay? There's no right or wrong answer here. So hands up. Do you think that we choose a song list based on us liking certain songs? Anyone? Oh, yeah, okay, yeah. I won't make a mental note. This is going to be gone after this morning, okay. Do you think we choose a song list because we want to sing the latest, newest song? Anyone? Do we base the song list on feelings that we might have? Okay, I'm not going to give you a right or wrong. Interest, it's just very interesting. Well, I can tell you actually, before that point, there are three principles that we have here at LifeSpring that help us decide what songs to sing and how we put them together. Firstly, it's an understanding that in any leadership area of the church, you have to love the church that you're leading. You have to have a pastoral heart. Actually, worship leading is a shepherding gift. We gather together and it's a gathering gift. And that's what anyone on this stage needs to have a passion for the local church, needs to love this church, LifeSpring. And anyone that doesn't shouldn't be on this stage. So that's the first kind of principle. And the second principle that we use is the Lord's Prayer. Okay, so we all know the Lord's Prayer, don't we? Hopefully, most of us. So the first part, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. So how does this affect our songs that we choose? Well, the first part of worship is a gathering upward looking part. And that means, you know, our Father who art in heaven is about who he is. Hallowed be your name, holy is your name. We declare truths about who he is, his awesomeness, his wonder, his holiness, his majesty. We want to get a big view of who God is, who Jesus is, and who the Holy Spirit is in our worship. And it's about his kingdom coming, his will be done. Yeah? We don't want to be about, God, we want you to do X, Y, and Z for us this morning. We want to get in line with what he would want to do this morning for us. It should be upward focused. Talking about his attributes to remind us that it's about his kingdom coming. And our job as worship leaders is to represent the truths of God to his people, that's you. To help us declare together what we know about God, what we've experienced of God, what he's done, and we're declaring it back to him. Worship's for him. It's not for us, it's for him. And next we get to give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we have also forgiven our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So once we've done that, once we've established who God is, this big picture of our wonderful God, we then get to us. We get to his provision actually for us and his forgiveness of us through the cross. And the cross must always be a central element to our worship together. It must always be a central element. And it's from the cross that we can know his provision, his power at work in our lives, his goodness to us, his forgiveness of us. I don't know if you noticed this morning, but the first couple of songs were kind of following that pattern, upward focused, holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. And then we got to Living Hope, which was about the cross. That was kind of the central point in our worship time. Jesus Christ, my living hope. It was all about the cross and his sacrifice and now who we are because of him. And lastly, yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever and ever. We get to then respond to this wonderful God, this wonderful gospel, these wonderful truths together. So that's principle two, the Lord's Prayer. And the third principle for building our song list is revelation and response. And this is an overarching umbrella to our corporate worship times. It's that understanding the dynamic that God reveals himself afresh to his people by his Spirit as we sing objective truth about him. Old truths that might have lost their life a little bit in us get reawoken by the power of the Holy Spirit as we sing them, as we declare them. That's the dynamic that's happening in our worship times. So we're not just blindly singing stuff. You know, we are expecting that these truths, these wonders of who God is, what he's done, will come to life again afresh in us on a Sunday morning to leave us encouraged, to leave us built up, to leave us ready to face whatever we're going to face, knowing that we are his and we've been accepted and loved. And not just knowing. You know, it moves from knowledge to knowing, moves from head to heart. That's what happens in a corporate worship time. That's what we're expecting to see. Okay, so we've spent our time on our list. We've applied these three principles to the songs that we put together. And I could do a whole day on how we actually build a song list and learning how to link songs in between one another. But we don't have time this morning. But I just wanted to give you a quick overview so that you know it's not just an arbitrary list of songs. It's not just something that we like doing, or we go, let's do our favourite one there, then our kind of one we kind of like there, and then we're going to get to our really, you know, the really kind of anointed one here. It's not about that. There's principles, there's understanding, there's actually theology behind it. And for us to understand that big picture is really helpful for when we come to worship. So next we come to the rehearsal. Thursday night is when we as a team rehearse our instruments. We come and spend a few hours on a Thursday night practicing together. Why do we do that? Music's an integral element to the how of corporate worship. Andrew Wilson says this in his book, Spirit and Sacrament. Don't underestimate the power of music. Music is indispensable. It is also theological. As anyone who's read the Old Testament will know, music has always played a central role, not just in expressing joy and encouraging thanksgiving, but also in entering God's presence and conquering the enemy. Music's a great facilitator of our worship of God. But it also helps release spiritual gifts, which we'll touch on later. Music is a gift from God, one in which, as I said, aids our worship. And Martin Luther, the great theologian, great church reformer, said this, next to the word of God, the noble art of music is the greatest treasure in the world. It controls our thoughts, minds, hearts, and spirits. This precious gift has been given to man alone that he might thereby remind himself that God has created man for the express purpose of praising and extolling God. However, when man's natural musical ability is whetted and polished to the extent that it becomes an art, then do we know with great surprise the great and perfect wisdom of God in music, which is, after all, his product and his gift. We marvel when we hear music in which one voice sings a simple melody while three, four, or five other voices play and trip lustily around the voice that sings its simple melody and adorn this simple melody wonderfully with artistic musical effects, thus reminding us of a heavenly dance where all meet in a spirit of friendliness, caress, and embrace. A person who gives this some thought and yet does not regard music as a marvelous creation of God must be a clodhopper indeed and does not deserve to be called a human being. He should be permitted to hear nothing but the braying of asses and the grunting of hogs. It's a great quote, isn't it? Music's a gift. Yeah, but you're back with me. Basically, the point is, Martin Luther saying, this music is a gift that should lead us to God. It should awaken us to the beauty and the wonder of God. And when you combine music with good theological songs, the two actually cause our hearts to open up, cause our emotions and our whole beings to get awoken. And then combine that with the Holy Spirit breathing on it and causing these songs to come to life, we get this wonderful picture of what God does during our worship times. All these three elements coming together, truth, music, the Holy Spirit, causing us to have this wonderful big picture of God and to experience him and to encounter him emotionally. So coming back, we've prepared ourselves. We've got our song list. We've rehearsed. We've got the music ready. And then what's next? What do we need? Well, we need the church. We need to gather. And my plea actually first to those who would class themselves as being part of this church here, LifeSpring, let us keep the Sunday gathering as something we prize highly. Let's really make it a foundation of our life together. Paul writes to the Hebrews about this. He says in Hebrews 10:24, and let us consider how to stir one another up. One another to love and to good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. You see, the church is one of the most beautiful, awe-inspiring, powerful things on this world. It's the vehicle which God's chosen to display his wisdom to the world. Do you view LifeSpring as part of that glorious church? World-changing church. Do you view what we do on a Sunday as changing the world? Good. That's great. Our Sunday gatherings are not simply where like-minded people gather together, sing a few songs that they like, and hear a heartwarming message. It's not what it's about. Rather, our Sunday gatherings are where we express the fact together that we've been grafted into one body. We are now a temple where the Holy Spirit dwells. where when we declare God's greatness and his majesty, the wonder of Jesus Christ, his sacrifice for us, and because of the cross, we can then encounter that same living God, where through spiritual gifts and when his living word is preached, we're sustained, encouraged, made more like Christ, and then through our lives, the world will know that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what the church is about. That's why it's important to come. Don't neglect to meet. You can't afford it. Your friends can't afford it. Your neighbors, colleagues, family can't afford you not coming on a Sunday. And not only that, I can't afford for you not to be here. But you not being here, playing your part in the body, I suffer, we all suffer. And the dynamic of being together is one where God loves to be. In fact, he promises, we all know that verse, don't we? Where two or three gather, he'll be there. But the verse just before says this, again, truly I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything they ask for, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three gather in my name, there I am with them. Do you wake up on a Sunday morning and think, if I'm not there today, that person might not get their miracle? Because you see, God's prepared good works for us to walk in, hasn't he? So do you wake up and think, if I'm not there, that person that is feeling incredibly lonely, that has been praying that God would speak to them through someone would notice them. If I'm not there, and I'm the one meant to do that, that person isn't going to get noticed. That's what it means about being part of family. That's what it means about playing your part in the body. Having a high view of church. That understanding that the church suffers if I don't play my part. That's the way the church is built. I didn't choose to build it like that. That's Jesus' choice. That's how he's chosen to build it. You've been grafted into that one body, and if you're suffering, the whole body suffers. If you don't play your part, the whole body suffers. You see, in our Western culture, your life is about you. It's about what's best for you, or me as an individual, isn't it? It's so often we wake up, and I have it, even today. I woke up and went, oh, I don't really want to go to church. Honestly, you know, it was probably because a little bit of dread of thinking I've got a lot to do and can I get it out? But there was still that element of going, you know, I had to choose to come and choose to go, no, I've got something to bring this morning because I know God's given me something to bring. I've got good works to step into and I'm trusting that God's going to use me to encourage and to build up the body. Do you come with that mindset? And we can actually even apply that too when we've made it to church. Okay, tick that box. I've made it to church. But are you present? Are you active? Or are you just going, okay, I'm going to sit back and basically entertain me? Are you looking to be on the front foot and encouraging those around you in their faith and their walk with God? And worship is one of those areas we're called to participate in. Again, really clear in the Bible, Ephesians 5:19, Colossians 3:16. Tells us to sing to one another, and that requires two things. Firstly, you're here. Secondly, that you sing. Yeah. It's important. That's why the Bible tells us, writes it down really clearly. It's an important aspect of our gathering together that we sing to one another to build each other up and encourage one another. So to summarize, we prepared a song list based on the truth of who God is. We put music in to help cause our emotions connect with our head knowledge. We've gathered together. We're ready to play an active part. We sing to one another, and then we can have faith God will move. And actually on this, we are going to be doing something slightly differently next week with a view of doing it a little bit more. We're calling it family worship. Now, before all of you start groaning and go, oh no, we're going to be doing kids' songs and it's going to be all, you know, have to dance and all that kind of stuff. You will have to dance, yes. But, yeah. But what we're going to be doing is we're going to be taking the two rows out the front here to create a little bit more space. It's actually something we did a Devoted Festival over the last few years. Devoted Festival is the festival of the family churches that we're together, that we're part of together. It meets in August, and I want to encourage you to sign up. But we do these things in the morning called family worship. Now, it's a little bit more structured. It's more intentional. It's around a certain theme. We're actually going to be going through, I don't know how many of you here when I preached on the Hebrew words for worship a while ago, but there's multiple words in Hebrew that express worship. And we're going to be going through them probably month by month at these family worship mornings and expressing how we do that together. So I think the first word's halal, is that right? which means to shout and praise God and make a big noise. So we're going to be doing that together. But all the kids are going to be in for the whole worship time. And the whole point is that we worship as family. So that means in your kind of nuclear family, so nucleus family, so parents with children, but then also as the church-wide family. For those that don't have kids, you're just as welcome, just as part of this. This is about us together learning how to worship and learning how to deepen and broaden and widen the way in which we worship. We're going to have someone come and do a spoken word piece as well. So yeah, encourage you, come next week, come prepared, come ready to dance, come ready to enjoy God as a family together. It's going to be a lot of fun. Great. Moving on. Spiritual gifts. Where do spiritual gifts fit in with our corporate worship times? Should we see them in operation? And how should we use them? Well, firstly, it's good just to define what we mean by spiritual gifts. And we can find that one of the definitions in the Bible in 1 Corinthians 12. There's a few, but I pulled this one out particularly. And I've used the Message translation. It just puts it in a slightly different way that is a little bit easier to understand. It says this: God's various gifts are handed out everywhere, but they all originate in God's Spirit. God's various ministries are carried out everywhere, but they all originate in God's Spirit. God's various expressions of power are in action everywhere, but God himself is behind it all. Each person is given something to do that shows who God is. Everyone gets in on it. Everyone benefits. All kinds of things are handed out by the Spirit and to all kinds of people. The variety is wonderful. Wise counsel, clear understanding, simple trust, healing the sick, miraculous gifts, acts, proclamation, distinguishing between spirits, tongues, interpretation of tongues. All these gifts have a common origin, but are handed out one by one by one Spirit of God. He decides who gets what and when. It's a pretty large and diverse list. And there's another place, multiple places where it talks about the gift of prophecy as well. Paul talks about that as a gift to us that we should highly prize and run after. And actually, and Paul says these gifts are given out as God chooses to each other in order that the world will see God. That it's for the benefit of all, but it's also for the benefit of all of mankind that we express and we use these spiritual gifts. So one thing, you know, one question to ask is, should we be using them? Yes, we should. And our Sunday meetings is a place to do that. That's what we believe as an eldership team. We want to see spiritual gifts grown, actively used, and also matured in each of us, depending on the gift that you've been given. And so speaking into LifeSpring, what do we want to see happen as we worship together? Well, that God is glorified through our singing, our reading, our listening, our responding, and using the gifts that we've been given, spiritual gifts. And I don't have time fully to expand on all the different spiritual gifts and why we should use them, but there's a great book called Spirit and Sacrament by Andrew Wilson that I've used. It's actually a really challenging book, one that we've probably got some things to talk about. Each of us have been reading it. And in terms of how we structure Sundays and how we do certain things. But it's a brilliant book. It does a fantastic section on spiritual gifts and why they should be used, why they're still active and present in today's church. So please go and read that. So Paul also helps us later on in Corinthians as he outlines some things that we should actually see happen when we gather together. 1 Corinthians 14, verses 26 to 33 says this: "What then shall we say, brothers and sisters? When you come together, each of you has a hymn or a word of instruction, a revelation, a tongue or an interpretation. Everything must be done so that the church may be built up. If anyone speaks in a tongue, two or at the most three should speak one at a time, and someone should interpret. If there is no interpreter, the speaker should keep quiet in the church and speak to himself and to God. Two or three prophets should speak, and the others should weigh carefully what is said. And if a revelation comes to someone who is sitting down, the first speaker should stop. For you can all prophesy in turn, so that everyone may be instructed and encouraged. The spirits of the prophets are subject to the control of the prophets." That's basically mean self-control. That's basically what you're saying there. If you prophesy, you can actually control when and where you should do that. For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all the congregations of the Lord's people. So what's Paul doing there? He's basically saying it's fine to have good order. It's actually a good thing. To have an understanding of where things should happen in a meeting, how things should get outworked in order that everyone's built up and encouraged. We can see in that passage there's where to expect hymns, So worship songs, essentially. Word of instruction. 2 Timothy 3:16 talks about scripture being useful for our instruction. So we can see that scripture being spoken, either that's kind of public reading of scripture or preaching. A revelation, so, you know, a prophetic thought, a word. Tongues and interpretation and prophecy when we gather together. And just a little point on tongues and interpretation. We often say about kind of speaking in tongues, and that's a gift that God has given to all of us to help us in our prayer life. It's a language that God gives us that enables us to be built up, encouraged individually. But when we're talking about the gift of tongues and interpretation, we're talking about something slightly different here. It's a public gift to build up and encourage the corporate church. And I'll talk a little bit more about how that should be applied in a second. But applying our revelation and response principle in worship, remember that? Understanding the flow of the song list, so the Lord's Prayer, that sense of we want to be gathered upward focus first, and then we get a chance to respond later. We can, and then putting these spiritual gifts in, we can start to see an order emerge of how we should use these gifts during our worship times together, how the songs that we sing and the gifts that we bring work together so that God is glorified. And it's not a them and us here thing. You know, we are called to work together, whether it's leading worship, whether it's anchoring the meeting, whether it's preaching, whether it's bringing a contribution, we're called to work together. And simply put, the order is this. Any gift that focuses our attention to who God is and what he has done for us fits in the revelation element of our worship times. Okay, does that make sense? So the public reading of scripture, tongues interpretation, and these gifts, they're kind of temperature rising gifts. They're turning the thermostat up in us. See, they help increase the fervency, the passion in our worship of God. And then anything that requires a response from us that we have to do something with, including prophecy, words of knowledge, should actually then happen later on in the meeting. A quick way to ascertain this is where something should come is to ask this question. What is the direction of travel of the contribution that I have to bring? So is it from me to God? Or is it from God to us? And if it's from me to God, the earlier part of our meeting is going to serve and aid us in our worship to God. If it's from God to us, the general rule here is we should wait for a while because we want to first get a big picture of who God is. We want to get him filled in our eye line, in our sights. And then actually that builds faith and builds us an expectation that when God moves, we're ready. We're ready for it because we've got this big view of who God is. So tongues interpretation, this gift is, like I said earlier, is different from speaking in tongues. When we bring an interpretation, it should always be from us to God. It's a really important thing to understand as well. So when someone comes and brings a public tongue on mic, and we use the mic because it's easy so everyone can hear, but it doesn't have to be a mic, people can shout it out. But that is a spontaneous overflow in worship of who God is and what suddenly they've been captured with, the individual's been captured with. And so the interpretation should always be that way as well. So from us to God, okay? Now, often what happens is when tongues interpretation happen, those that have prophetic gifts, that those that hear God and speak words that require action or combination of doing something along with God, their gift gets kind of activated in that moment because the Holy Spirit's moving. And so sometimes, I think it happened a few weeks ago where someone brought into a tongue, public tongue, someone came and actually prophesied off the back of it. The prophecy was great, but it wasn't the interpretation because it was from God to us. We then waited and then there was an interpretation that came which was from us to God. And as Paul said, the reason I'm making a bit of a point here on it is it's good to have good order. It's good to have an understanding of the dynamics of how spiritual gifts are used and when they should be used, because actually we want to build each other up and not detract. And the reason we put prophecy and words of knowledge either at the end of worship or the end of the kind of preach time is really, a practical thing. You know, it helps us not detract our focus away from God, actually. And I'll talk about that in a second. But it allows actually time for us to respond. We want to give time to respond. So if God speaks that requires action on our part, we want to act, don't we? And sometimes that means a moment in the meeting. It sometimes means things you need to do in the week. But we want to give time for us to act properly. And as a worship leader, remember, my job is to represent the truths of God, of who God is, Jesus' sacrifice, to remind you of your position in Christ and to gather us. And the reason this is important in terms of having good order, so picture this. We're one song in, okay? You've understood this long kind of journey that we have in worship, this big picture. And I've got two more songs prepared that take us to a place of remembering the cross. We want to get to the cross. Someone gets up, grabs the microphone, and brings a word of knowledge that someone here has got a broken toe on their left foot. Okay, so there's nothing wrong with that word of knowledge at all. Actually, particularly if someone is here with a broken toe on their left foot. Amazing. We want to celebrate courage. We want to celebrate accuracy with it like that. But actually, for those that don't have a broken toe on their left foot, what do we do? Some might stay engaged, but some might just go, okay, well, that's for that person. And I'm just going to switch off for a second here. I'm just going to disconnect. And for me as a worship leader, when my primary job is to help gather all of us together, one song in, I'm basically having to start again from scratch. That's why we sometimes say no to people. It's not because we don't think the word is good or that you've heard from God. It's just having that big picture of what we're doing together and where we are in the journey of the meeting. And that's just learning what we need as people. You remember our primary reason we gather together is to worship and adore God. We want to come and focus our attention on God so that anything helps us corporately do that, we'll encourage at the beginning of meetings, and anything draws our attention to the things that we need to do or he wants to do in us, a best place towards the end of the meeting. It's quite a simple thing. But I felt it was good to clear that up and to explain that, because we want to encourage spiritual gifts. We want to encourage those that hear from God, that have prophetic words for us, that have words of knowledge, but to have an understanding of the dynamic of the whole, because we want to play a part as a whole. It's a team sport. And flowing together in these gifts is important, as we aren't meant to operate in isolation, are we? As I said, church is a team sport. And as Paul says, each one of us have been given different gifts for the benefit of the whole. So again, as I said, to understand the dynamics of a corporate meeting, to understand where we are in the journey of our meeting together is important, because it helps us then apply our gifts in a really good way, in a most effective way, to build up and encourage the whole. And interestingly, we can see where worship or music can actually release these gifts as well. In 2 Kings 3, Elisha, a prophet, said this. Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord Almighty lives, whom I serve, if I did not have respect for the presence of Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, I would not pay any attention to you. But now, bring me a harpist." I love that. Bring me a harpist. Bring me a harpist. Where is it? Yeah. "While the harpist was playing, the hand of the Lord came on Elisha, and he said, 'This is what the Lord says.'" He then goes to prophesy this amazing prophetic word about the valley being filled with water, but not from rain, and it's about God's presence being poured out. But actually, we see that the harpist created an environment and an atmosphere for Elisha to prophesy out of. Again, it's that connection. It's not Elisha was an established prophet. He knew how to hear God, but he wanted team. He wanted someone else in the mix, and actually, he knew that he needed a harpist for that moment to come and play, to release what was in him properly. And again, all through the Psalms, we see that. We see David writing Psalms. And if you notice, quite often before a Psalm, it says, like there's an instruction to the kind of music leader, and it'll be to be played on strings or to be played on whatever, trumpets and, you know, that brass things. And actually, what was David doing then? He was saying, the song that I have is best accompanied with this kind of music to release the heart of what I'm singing about and saying. Okay, this combination, this connection, this tying together, this releasing one another. Okay, you still with me? Good, good. Now, I'm generalizing a little bit here, which is okay, because in it all, we must be people who listen and respond to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our leader, isn't he? He's the one that we are led by. And so it's our job to follow him when he wants to do something differently. So with all this good order, we can still throw it all out the window if God's moving and we want to respond to him. And we're spirit-led people, so that's okay. But as I said, to have good order in our meeting is clearly something we should be talking about and doing, as Paul clearly tells us in the Bible, in Corinthians. Hopefully that's been clear and helpful in laying a foundation for us to worship God together whilst understanding the dynamics of what happens when we gather together. And for those that aren't Christians this morning, that maybe you're visiting us for the first time, probably a lot of what I've spoken about this morning has gone right over your head, and that's okay. But what I want to simply tell you is that God loves you. There's a God in heaven that loves you, that he sent his son Jesus to die for you, that shame, guilt, fear, all the things that you've ever done wrong, where you've ever hurt anyone, Jesus took upon himself on the cross and restored relationship for you back to God. And it's simple. All you have to do is say, God, Jesus, I want to follow you. I want to follow you as my Lord and Savior. And I'd be amiss to give you not an opportunity to hear that this morning. And I know 90% of this word has been for those that would call themselves Christians, but God's speaking this morning and he wants to speak to you. And so we're going to do in a minute, we're going to actually do an activation for us as a church in worship, and which is going to require all of us to be present and to sing. But whilst that's going on, if you don't know God, why don't you simply just pray, God, would you reveal yourself to me this morning? Would you show me who you are? If you're real, show me who you are. And if that's you and you do pray that prayer, please come down to the front at the end. Come share that with me. I'd love to talk and introduce you to Jesus, or come and connect with us at the Engage point as well. It's really important we do that.